Welcome to Asia's Young IAS. In this video, we are going to look at current affairs for week 3 of June 2020, that is from 15th June to 21st June. So let's take a look at the index. The segregation has been done of the topics based on polity, social, economy, environment, and even international and bilateral relations. So the key words have also been underlined. So as you look here, you can see. So in polity, Rajya Sabha elections have been detailed out in the Sunday newspaper. That is 21st June newspaper. So that has been covered in detail. That comes in your polity. Then in polity, judiciary, all those issues which have been picked up by the Supreme Court, like on the loan moratorium scheme of the RBI, virtual court system, BS4 vehicles, the leeway which was given by the Supreme Court, it says it has been misused. About AGR, adjusted gross revenues, when non-telecom PSUs have been asked to pay by the government. So that is an issue. So all that has been covered. So whatever are the key words have been underlined here. So if you should know everything about that, everything revolving around that. Then regarding health, there are two important drugs which have come in news presently. One is dexamethasone and Fabiflu. We'll discuss that. In social issues related to women, PCPNDT rules have been relaxed but suspended by the government. Supreme Court is questioning that too. And then regarding two schemes, Vandhan Yojana, Garib Kalyan Rozgar Abhiyan, then rights related issues and policy related issues like the Vande Bharat scheme which is going on, bringing Indians back. Then Khelo India centers have been planned with respect to sports. Then regarding environment, Lunar Lake has changed its color. It has turned pinkish. So we'll discuss all about Lunar Lake, which is actually a crater lake, a lake created by a crater. Then regarding urban jungle, about Guwahati. So this aspect also will be covered. Then in economy also have exports data which has come for May. Exports have fallen while imports have also fallen at a much higher pace. So trade deficit has actually narrowed. So we'll discuss all these news. Plus bilateral relations, the Galwan Valley issue between India and China will be discussed in detail. And international issues also, there are these keywords again which you should be aware of, like regarding DACA with respect to USA, what is it all about, the dreamers in USA, so we'll discuss that. What is Juneteenth with respect to the black rights also, Black Rights Matter as is the hashtag trending presently. Then regarding GAFA, what are these digital giants? So it stands for actually Google, Apple, Facebook and Amazon. So we see regarding taxing these digital giants, what is the issue between USA and European countries too, and across the globe too. And regarding North Korea now redeploying troops in demilitarized zones between North and South Korea. And Uyghur rights bill which USA has passed. So what is that also you should know. It has been quite often in news. And with international organizations, the news here is with respect to IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency. So we'll discuss about this organization. While even at the UN Security Council, India has won a non-permanent seat. So we'll discuss that too. So let's start with it. So first is polity legislature related news. The first news is, how are the Rajya Sabha polls different? So if you have done polity, you should be knowing that Rajya Sabha, the English name for it is Council of States, as mentioned in the Constitution too. Plus, it is a permanent house, means its members stay, means it does not get dissolved at any point of time, the way Lok Sabha does. If it completes a 5-year term or in between too, if the government loses its majority and fresh elections are to be conducted. But Rajya Sabha is a permanent house. But then every member of the Rajya Sabha has a fixed term and that term is of 6 years. So every 2 years, 1/3 members resign. So that's how the adjustment has been made. So every 2 years, 1/3 members complete their 6-year term and they resign and they are out and fresh elections are held. And these are not direct elections. Lok Sabha has direct elections, Rajya Sabha has indirect elections in the sense that state's legislative assemblies vote for Rajya Sabha elections. So only elected members of the state legislative assemblies can vote in the Rajya Sabha elections. This is another important point. And every 2 years, as we saw, each member has a 6-year term. So every 2 years, 1/3 members resign and they are retire and they are to be, the posts have to be re-elected. So vacancies can arise otherwise too. It's not necessary that every 2 years, in between also, like if there's a resignation or death or disqualification, then bipolls are also conducted for Rajya Sabha elections. And how is the voting done? Voting is a single transferable vote based on principle of proportional representation. So what do these terms imply? We'll see that also. So actually principle of proportional representation is used. It means the principle of majority is not used. In the sense that if states are electing members to Rajya Sabha, so every state has a fixed number of seats which it sends to Rajya Sabha, and that is also mentioned in the constitution, the schedule of the constitution, the fourth schedule. So what happens is states' representation in Rajya Sabha is not by principle of majority, in the sense that if one state has, suppose, say 10 seats going to Rajya Sabha, for example. So these 10 seats, who will decide how will these 10 seats be elected by the state legislative assembly? If majority voting is done, then the party which is in power in the state will have majority in the legislative assembly. So whatever they say, all the 10 members will be from the ruling party of the state, what the ruling party decides. But that is not the case. Principle of majority is not used. Principle of proportional representation is used. Means if there are 10 seats going from a state to Rajya Sabha, and that state legislative assembly has, say, 100 members, out of which 60 members are from the ruling party. So means out of 10 seats, 6 proportionally out of 160. So 6 seats will go from ruling party and 4 seats will go from remaining. So it will be a replica of the state legislative assembly at the Rajya Sabha level. Means they will decide each member. So it's a principle of proportional representation which is used for election to Rajya Sabha, and it is a single transferable vote. So how do votes take place? You can see your priorities has to be given. So when you are voting, elected members of Rajya Sabha vote, and these members are not from only the states, the 29 states or 28 states presently, but also from two union territories, Delhi and Puducherry, because these two union territories also have their legislative assembly. So elected members from the legislative assembly of these two union territories also vote for Rajya Sabha. And see, single transferable vote means electors can vote for any number of candidates in order of their preference. So they have to give an order of preference. Like my first preference is, say, candidate A, second preference candidate B. So each candidate's vote, first preference votes are counted, and then it is seen who gets majority. So that person is elected. Then second round goes on. If the person, one person does not get a clear majority. So that's how it works, single transferable vote. It is used in presidential elections too. Then another point is, there is no secret ballot in Rajya Sabha elections. So Rajya Sabha polls have open ballot, but then it is a limited form of openness. Openness in the sense that your voting is not secret, it's not only known to you, but the party head as such knows. So there's a authorized agent of each political party. He is shown, like each party MLA has to show his or her marked ballots to the party's authorized agent before they are put in the ballot box. It is not a secret ballot, party should know. And showing a marked ballot to anyone other than own party's authorized agent will make the vote invalid. And not showing the ballot to the authorized agent also means that the vote cannot be counted. Independent candidates which do not belong to any political party, they are barred from showing their ballots to anyone. So that's how it works. Then another issue is with respect to nota, none of the above. So Election Commission of India actually issued circulars in 2014 and 15, giving Rajya Sabha members also option to press nota button, none of the above button, in Rajya Sabha elections. But in 2018, Supreme Court struck this provision down, saying that nota option is only for general elections, which is conducted on the basis of universal adult suffrage and cannot be applied to indirect elections based on proportional representation. So there is no nota now in Rajya Sabha elections. Means you have to vote for candidates. And another aspect is, does cross-voting attract disqualification? So the Supreme Court has ruled in this matter and said that while declining to interfere with the open ballot system, because political party comes to know whom you are voting for. So if there is a cross voting, political party will come to know. But if your vote is invalidated only if you do not show. Your vote is not invalidated if you vote cross party. Means you belong to one political party but you are voting for somebody else. You have shown. So the party comes to know that you have cross voted. So your vote is valid because you have shown your ballot, you have not kept it secret. But Supreme Court said that does not mean that the person would be disqualified under the anti-defection law. But it says that the political party comes to know that their party member has voted against the party line. So they can take disciplinary action against the legislator concerned. And lastly, a question arises, can a legislator vote without taking oath as a member of the assembly? So MLAs are voting, state legislative assembly members. So if a person has not taken oath as a legislator, he has been elected, he is a member, but he has not taken oath. So can they vote for Rajya Sabha elections? So on this also, Supreme Court has ruled that yes, they can, even if they have not taken oath, because this is a non-legislative activity and can be performed without taking oath. So this is it. So that's all. So what we covered right now is this topic from polity legislature. Next, what we are going to cover is polity judiciary, which says the headline is no benefit from RBI's loan moratorium scheme, Supreme Court. So what is it all about? We'll see. So by now you must be aware of the loan moratorium scheme the RBI has announced. So what it says is that the loans which have to be repaid, there will be EMIs, monthly installments, which equated monthly installments. So these monthly installments during these lockdown months, so they can be delayed. So this payment can be delayed. So earlier it was for 3 months and it has been extended for up to 6 months now. So the payment can be delayed. But then the payment can be delayed, it has been clarified, does not mean that you will not have to pay interest. So because it has been delayed, the time duration increases, so interest will also increase. So your equated monthly installment will increase if you are not paying at this time. So this is a benefit which can be accrued, but it has been seen that there are not many takers for this scheme of the government. The Supreme Court is also hearing this matter and it says there are few takers for this RBI's loan moratorium scheme during the lockdown because people know that there was hardly any benefit arising out of it. So the government, represented by Solicitor General Tushar Mehta, appeared before the court and he said that he has met finance ministry officials and RBI officials and has explained that the moratorium during the pandemic lockdown is not a waiver. So it's not a loan waiver being given. A complete waiver of deferred loan interest would have a serious cascading effect, he says, on the financial interests of the depositors because banks get money from the depositors. So that's what Solicitor General is saying. The court is being told by the government, and the court has consistently questioned RBI and the government over one issue, whether this deferment of loan interest would lead to charging of interest on interest, because interest has to be paid during this period. And that interest is not being paid. So, will there be interest charged on interest is a question. So, after 6 months, that is on 31st August 2020, this loan moratorium would end. So, what would happen then is a question being asked by the Supreme Court, but the government has not clarified on this yet. And the case will be further heard. So far, this is the development. You should know about the RBI moratoriums. So, here you can see this is regarded with respect to home loans. So, borrower can pay the EMI payments by later, defer that payment for 3 months. Now, it has been extended to 6 months. So, you can see it was up to 31st May, from 1st March to 31st May. Now, it has been extended to 31st August. So, it is up to the banks to decide the criteria for establishing who can avail this. Because EMI payments will be delayed, but then who will be the beneficiaries? The banks decide. And also, deferment of EMI payment, it has been clarified, will not affect the credit score. So, the person's credit score would not be affected, the borrower's credit score, and borrower will continue to accrue interest on the home loan during the moratorium period. So, that point is there. Then next issue which we'll cover, so this is the first topic in polity judiciary which we covered. Now, the second topic is Supreme Court to extend virtual court system amid COVID-19 fears. So now you should know what is this virtual court system. So actually the Supreme Court has been functioning even during the lockdown through video conferencing. So it is hearing urgent cases through video conferencing, and this is what the Supreme Court is calling as the virtual court system. But the majority of the lawyers actually say they cannot effectively present their arguments at virtual hearings, and they are calling for resumption of physical hearings by July. But Supreme Court presently, a 7-member committee, as such of the Supreme Court judges led by Justice N.V. Ramanna, has decided that they'll continue with the virtual court system and not revert to the physical hearings because there is alarming growth of COVID-19 cases presently. So it would not be feasible. Then next is Supreme Court bars sale of registration of BS4 vehicles. Earlier order allowing sale misused. So you must be aware of the timeline actually. This is regarding Bharat Stage 4. So this is emission standards for vehicles in the country, and what we had decided is BS4 will, from BS4 will jump to BS6, will skip BS5, the BS5 emission standards. These are, you know, Euro standards replicated. So Indian version of Euro standards. So BS5 would be jumped and will jump to BS6, and this was to be made effective from 1st April 2020. Means all BS4 vehicles should be phased out by 1st April 2020 and only Bharat Stage 5-6 vehicles would be allowed. But what happened was on 24th March we had the lockdown. So that's why this deadline was delayed. Supreme Court had given some leeway, but then it is seen that this order has been misused, because what Supreme Court allowed was leeway to for sale of 10% of unsold BS stock as such. But then it has been seen that vehicles of BS4 vehicles are being sold, and that is why it has ordered the center to collect details on how many BS4 vehicles have been sold and registered after the national lockdown was lifted. Still, it has been used, the Supreme Court leeway as such. So, trucks and buses actually for these is for vehicles, two wheelers, four wheelers, but for trucks and buses, they get time up till September 30, 2020 to become BS6 compliant. These are the most advanced emission standards for automobiles and is equivalent to Euro 6 norms. And they reduce vehicular pollution. The new norms make onboard diagnostic mandatory for all vehicles. OBD. So OBD unit can identify likely areas of malfunction by means of default codes stored on a computer. And for two wheelers, manufacturers will introduce a fuel injection system, which will be a first in the country. The detail as such about how BS4 engines have to be upgraded to be made BS6 compliant. So you can see BS5 stage would have required a key fitment in the engine. So that will have to be done for BS6, and so one more is for BS6. So two changes have to be made. That is, one is diesel particulate filter as well as selective catalytic reduction technology. So both will have to be done when we are jumping from BS4 to BS6. What is diesel particulate filter? You should know, DPF is a cylinder mounted vertically inside the engine compartment, and its function is to remove particulate matter, as the name suggests. Particulate matter are soot from the diesel exhaust, and it needs temperature of 600 degrees Celsius, which is difficult in Indian conditions. So small cars popular in India with limited bonnet space would need major redesign to accommodate this diesel particulate filter. Then also with respect to selective catalytic reduction technology, SCR, actually here what does this do? It reduces oxides of nitrogen by injecting aqueous solution into the system. So this reduces oxides of nitrogen. So this solution as such contains ammonia, for which a separate container needs to be put. So this here the problem would be an anti-defect mechanism needs to be put in the vehicles as such, so that separately they can, a separate infrastructure is needed for this as such to countrywide supply of this aqueous solution to AUS32, which is required for selective catalytic reduction technology. So these are some modifications which need to be done in the engines to make them BS6 compliant. You can see the standards, what each of the standards emissions allowed, like nitrogen oxide emissions allowed and particulate matter 2.5 emissions allowed. Under BS6, you can see from BS4 25, it reduces to 5, and from 250, it reduces to 80. So Bharat stage standards, when they have been implemented, the dates have been given here. Bharat stage 4 has been effective from 2012. Bharat stage 5 had to be made effective from 2017, but it has been skipped, and from 2020 it has been decided to go to directly to Bharat stage 6. Then next is, so there are four issues under polity judiciary. First one was regarding the loan moratorium scheme, where the Supreme Court is demanding whether interest on interest would be charged after the 6-month moratorium given on loans. And second was regarding virtual court system, which the Supreme Court said will continue. There will be no physical hearings for now. Third was regarding BS4 vehicles, which we just discussed, that this order allowing leeway 10% sale has been misused even after the lockdown has been revoked. And finally, the last news in polity judiciary is AGR demand from non-telco PSUs withdrawn. Government tells Supreme Court. So what is this AGR? You should know, adjusted gross revenue. So this was actually a tax dispute between the government and the telecom companies. So how the revenue has to be collected, the telecom department insisted that it should be adjusted gross revenue basis. But the telecom companies refused. What is adjusted gross revenue? We'll have a look at that too, first of all. You can see. So AGR is an annual revenue from all carriers combined that accrues to the government. So means it will be from all benefits, like definition of AGR, that it would continue. You can see, like, not only the license agreement, but non-core revenue as such will also be included under it. So that was the definition of AGR. Like you can see, a telco's AGR should include all revenue earned by service provider, including that emanating from non-core sources such as rent, profit on sale of fixed assets or sale of scrap, corporate deposits, real estate transactions, handset sales, dividend income, etc. So all revenue, when revenue taxation has to be decided on, non-core sectors sources also have to be included. So that's what the telecom department demanded. So there was a dispute. So telecom companies actually did not pay the revenue. So at what rate they have to pay? So that was not decided, and that dispute continued. And this huge amount of tax has been accrued now. And the case went up to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court ruled in favor of the telecom department and said that telecom companies have to pay revenue based on AGR, adjusted gross revenue, not just on core source income, that is on services provided, telecom services provided, but also non-core sources. So because of this ruling of the Supreme Court, now telecom companies have to pay huge amount as revenue, and the telecom companies were already under stress even before the COVID-19 issue came up. So there was a new entity in the market, Jio, a new company, and that did not have this dispute. So Jio is not included in AGR because it's an old dispute. It's an issue since 2003. Jio did not exist then. So that's what the whole thing is about now. So the other telecom companies have to pay this huge amount of taxation, and they were already suffering because of this disruptor in the market, and now the COVID-19 case is also come forth. The Supreme Court says that this is a time when telecom companies are earning when others are not. So the whole issue is still there. So this demand made by the Supreme Court said the payment has to be made within 3 months, but telecom companies were not able to make the payment. Some initial payment was made by Bharti Airtel and even Vodafone. But since the full payment could not be made and representation was made to the government also gave them leeway. The government gave them 20 years time, that over a period of 20 years they can pay this pending amount. So this has been questioned by the Supreme Court too. Supreme Court says that how could they give this time? So that was another matter, and then later it came to be known that so government is demanding this adjusted gross revenue concept is being applied to non-core telecom companies, telecom PSUs too. Non-telecom PSUs means the ruling of the Supreme Court was for telecom companies, not public sector undertakings also, but government public sector undertakings means government companies. Government is demanding tax from government PSUs on the basis of AGR because of Supreme Court ruling. So Supreme Court has been angered by this actually. And here you can see the Supreme Court had questioned this, and now Union Government has informed the Supreme Court that it has withdrawn 96% of its 4 lakh crore demand in adjusted gross revenue which it had made from non-telecom public sector undertakings. Means government does not have money, government seeks money from PSUs in the form of tax. PSUs are their own companies, they're taxing their own companies. So political parties, money is not taxed, whatever donations political parties get is not taxed at all, but PSUs will be taxed. PSUs money, they have to pay money to the government as tax, and that also on the basis of adjusted gross revenue, not just on the core services. Non-core services should also be included and tax should be paid. So such was the demand made by the government when court pulled up the government for misusing its October 2019 judgment to get money from PSUs. So then the government has informed the Supreme Court that it has withdrawn such demands. Also, court is still hearing the matter because it is looking into the viability of the government's proposed formula to stagger repayment of dues from telecom companies over a period of 20 years. So how this will work, what will be the guarantee? So telecom company, have to give the submissions on this too. So case is still being heard. Then next is social health related issues. So here we have two issues. First one is regarding cheap drug dexamethasone, how it helps COVID patients on ventilator recover. So this is according to a study in which it has been said that dexamethasone, which is an inexpensive steroid that costs less than 10 rupees for 10 ml. So, and it is made by several Indian manufacturers. So this can help in saving lives of serious COVID-19 patients on ventilators. So it's a very cheap, expensive drug. Even World Health Organization administered recovery trial has been undertaken to test various drugs, and these are repurposed drugs, means they are drugs for some other purposes, but they are repurposed right now for treating COVID-19. It has also reported that dexamethasone reduces death by one third in ventilated patients and by one fifth in other patients receiving oxygen only. So for patients requiring oxygen, this steroid drug helps. And this is regarding how cases have been faring in various states in the country. The graph being shown. The next is Fabiflu. Glenmark launches drug Favipiravir for moderate COVID-19 patients. So for serious COVID-19 patients, we have this inexpensive drug dexamethasone. For moderate and mild symptoms also, we have already been using hydroxychloroquine, the antimalarial drug, which is again a very cheap drug. But Glenmark has now launched this drug Favipiravir for moderate COVID-19 patients. It has the brand name Fabiflu. So this is an oral antiviral drug for COVID-19 patients. So this is for patients in the age group 18 to 75 years with mild to moderate symptoms, not in serious cases. And this is a drug which will be available in a strip of 34 tablets for 3,500 rupees. And the first day dose is 18 tablets. You have to take 18 tablets in one day on the first day, 9 in the morning, 9 in the evening. Second day, 4 each twice daily, and treatment can go on for 14 days. And it says patients can also stay at home. So company has received approval from the Indian drug regulator for manufacturing and marketing this in oral form in India. So clinical trial is further been undertaken as such too at 11 sites in India for the drug, and it is for restricted use. It can be it will be sold strictly on only on prescription, and responsible medication is required. Every patient must have to sign informed consent before starting the treatment. So this is regarding Fabiflu. The next is ICMR study plots mid-November peak. So in quality health, there are three issues. One was regarding dexamethasone for ventilator patients, the cheap steroid drug. And second was regarding Fabiflu, the Glenmark drug for moderate COVID-19 cases. And last news in social health is ICMR study saying that there will be a peak in COVID-19 cases in mid-November. So this is regarding when COVID-19 cases in the country will peak. Peak means they will be at the maximum level and then they will start reducing. So this is a study which has been undertaken by researchers from Operations Research Group constituted by ICMR. And these researchers, they have said that the peak stage of COVID-19 in India will be in November, mid-November. And it is said it has been delayed by 8-week lockdown. So we have had lockdown for 8 weeks. So this has resulted in peaking being delayed. So here you can see it says that the intensified public health measures with 60% effectiveness after the lockdown are being seen. So demand for treatment facilities can be met until the first week of November. After that, there will be shortage. So isolation beds would be inadequate for 5.4 months. It says ICU beds will be inadequate for 4.6 months and ventilators for 3.9 months. So this shortfall is estimated to be 83% less than what it could have had been without the lockdown and public health measures. So this is being highlighted in this study, and also there is varying pace of epidemic in various regions. So based on that also, infrastructure requirement, how they would be met is to be seen. But then it is said the overall economic health system cost because of the pandemic has been 6.2% of India's GDP. All this is what the study says, but later ICMR dissociated itself from the study, which, though it is co-authored by at least two of its in-house scientists and also the chairman of the government appointed National COVID Task Force. So they are co-authors, but ICMR has presently dissociated itself because of the concerns, because it means that COVID-19 cases would go on for long. So this information is coming in public domain. There will be inadequacies that is coming in public domain. So is speculated under government pressure, ICMR, as it has been denying that there is no community transmission, it is denying and rejecting this report too. It has nothing to do with this report. Then next is social women related issues. So first one is no rise in domestic violence cases, says National Commission for Women chairperson. So National Commission for Women actually registered an increase of at least 2.5 times in domestic violence complaints during the nationwide lockdown from 25th March to 31st May. So this is official data showing that number of complaints have increased 2.5 times, at least 2.5 times, means more than doubled. But then Union Women and Child Development Minister Smriti Irani had stated that there is no increase in such incidents, and NGOs were scaremongering. They were scaring people that there are domestic violence cases are increasing. And after that, the data came from National Commission for Women. But then NCW chairperson also then came to the rescue of the statement given by Union Women and Child Development Minister Smriti Irani, and she said, Ms. Rekha Sharma, she said that there is no spurt in domestic violence in the country. Though the figure shows more complaints, she says that this is only rise in reporting of crimes. Means, if the numbers are high in complaints, the NCW chairperson says that this number is high because more people are reporting. It does not mean there are more cases. If you try to interpret this statement, it means that there have been domestic violence cases in the country even before the lockdown and presently too, but they were not reported. Now they are being reported. So there are huge number of cases earlier too and huge number of cases presently too is what can be interpreted, and now they are being reported. That's why numbers have increased. And why they have been reported, it says they had started a WhatsApp number, so people are reporting. So of course it's a cause of concern, but this is how it is dismissed, that it's only reporting. Also another justification being given, she emphasized that 99% of the complaints were not new cases. Means they are old cases. And this is further scary. So if you say that the number only complaints have increased, and complaints have increased also not from new people complaining, so there's no rise in domestic violence. But even if old people are complaining again, 99% complaints are old, means what is the step being taken? What is the use of complaints to if the relief is not provided to these domestic violence victims? So this is, you can see, she says, the statement is, many survivors who have approached us say they have been experiencing violence at home for past several years. These are not new cases for us. So this shows the pathetic condition of National Commission for Women, and also about how data, the data which comes forth, how it is tried to be misinterpreted and tried to be shown in such a way that it doesn't show bad light on the government and does not show any problem. Covering up the problems, data, if there is data which is not favorable, you cover up in such a way that everything looks rosy. That's the idea, which is disappointing. Here you can see, this is data from National Family Health Survey. It says 42% Indian women, 42% Indian men see no wrong in hitting their wives. So this is NFHS survey. 42% believe this. And domestic violence cases reported during the lockdown period in Punjab itself is 700. Then next is, why suspend PCPNDT sex test routes? Supreme Court asks government. Now another thing which has been done during the lockdown period is government suspended the rules under PCPNDT. You should know about PCPNDT has been asked in prelims also by UPSC. So you should know about this. What is it all about? PCPNDT, the acronym was questioned. So what is the acronym? You should know. Preconception and prenatal diagnostic techniques. Prohibition of sex selection. It's an act and rules are formulated under the act. So means preconception means even before conceiving, there are technologies presently which can determine sex or select sex of the unborn child. And also there are prenatal diagnostic techniques, means to know the sex of the child while pregnant. So all these are being prohibited under this act. And there are rules formulated under it, but these rules have presently been put on hold. The implementation of the certain rules by the Union Health Ministry. So this was a notification which came on April 4th. So after the lockdown on March 24, on April 4th this notification came. It's a formal notice of the government. So actually this notification has resulted in case being filed before the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court has also questioned what was the need to suspend these crucial rules of a parliamentary law against prenatal sex determination and sex selection till June end. So from April till June, these rules are being suspended because of COVID-19 nationwide lockdown. So how could government temporarily freeze rules framed under parliamentary law through a mere notification is being questioned. So suspended provisions also are related to mandatory registration of genetic counseling centers, laboratories and clinics. They have to be registered. So this rule has been suspended. If they are not registered, it's fine. So illegal suspension of rules while medical establishments continue to function will provide avenue for misuse of the technology. So why did the government do this is being questioned in the Supreme Court now. So this is the PCP and DT Act. Parliament enacted it to stop female feticide and arrest declining sex ratio in the country. Means number of females per 1000 males. So here you can see the Act of 1994, it says no person, organization or laboratory having ultrasound or any imaging machine shall determine or communicate the sex of the fetus. Registration of genetic counseling centers etc. is mandatory under the Act. No person shall sell any ultrasound machine or scanner to any other equipment or any other equipment capable of detecting the sex of the fetus to a genetic counseling center which is not registered under the Act. So these were the provisions as such, but still there are leeways and it has been misused, and now the rules have been relaxed as such, means it is allowed. There is no control on what's going on. The rules do not apply presently during the lockdown. So questions have been raised in the Supreme Court, and rightly so, on this step of the government. So after social health, in social women, we saw two news items. One was no rise in domestic violence cases being claimed by National Commission for Women chairperson, and second was regarding PCP and DT sex test rules being suspended and Supreme Court is questioning government on that. Next, we come to social schemes, and the first scheme being discussed is Vandhan Yojana, which is helping tribals. So Vandhan Yojana was launched on 15th August 2019 to ensure that Vandhan, one means forest, dhan means wealth. So it means forest wealth. Forest wealth should stay in the hands of forest dwellers. So it provides a local platform to them for processing, value addition, marketing and sale of their miners' forest produce. So products range from variety of commodities like hill brooms, wild honey, candles, aloe vera soaps, murabba, laddu, etc. So they are supported by TriFed too, that is Tribal Cooperative Marketing Federation of India. So in partnership with them, there are these Vandhan Vikas Kendras which are being established, which enable people to start making the commodities themselves, the tribals, from the minor forest produce and sell it themselves. So the middlemen do not accrue all the profits. So Hill Broom Project of Nagaland, this is in Nagaland's poorest district, Langling. So this tribal community is here, they used to have Hill Broom's grass sold for a meager amount. Now they are manufacturing the brooms and selling them for a good price. So this is regarding Vandhan Yojana. So you should know this, empowering tribal communities through value addition. So various self-help groups have been established under it, and they have been provided with working capital, training, and they are marketing their produce as such themselves. So there are these Vandhan Vikas Kendras which have been established. Also big corporates are proposed to be involved under the PPP model, public-private partnership model. Then next is the second scheme, Garib Kalyan Rozgar Abhiyan, 50,000 crore scheme for migrants. So these are the two schemes being covered in this week. So this Garib Kalyan Rozgar Abhiyan is actually similar to MGNREGA, but a new name being given and a new scheme being launched. This has been launched on 20th June 2020 to offer immediate employment opportunities to migrant workers who have returned to their villages because of COVID-19. So it is said estimated 1 crore migrant workers have returned. So this scheme is not all over India. This is for 116 districts across 6 states that have been identified to be having highest number of workers returning during the lockdown. So these states are Bihar, Jharkhand, UP, MP, Odisha and Rajasthan. So they will be, they will be provided employment to create infrastructure in the rural regions, and this is what even MGNREGA does. So there is specific funding for this. You can see 50,000 crore for these specific districts. So we had already seen UP and other governments, they were doing skill mapping, and now a separate scheme being launched for these specific regions by the government. So this is the detail regarding the scheme Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Rozgar Abhiyan, launched on 20th June 2020. So it is to empower and provide livelihood opportunities to returning migrant workers and rural citizens. It has a focused campaign of 125 days across 116 districts in 6 states. It is a mission mode project, and public work worth 50,000 crore will be carried out under the scheme, and has plans to have focused implementation on 25 different types of works. So this will provide employment as well as create durable infrastructure as under MGNREGA. Then next is 3 states yet to reply on labor law changes. So now this is with respect to social rights. So what we discussed so far was social schemes. So the two schemes, one was Vandhan Yojana to help tribals, and second is Garib Kalyan Rozgar Abhiyan. So this is a 50,000 crore scheme launched on 20th June 2020 by the government, central government, for migrant workers. Next we come to social rights. So in social rights, the first news which we are seeing is here that three states are yet to reply on labor laws. So labor laws have been diluted. Parliamentary Committee on Labour has written to 8 state governments seeking explanation on the changes they brought to the labour laws during the extended lockdown. And out of these 8 states, 3 are BJP ruled states, that is UP, MP and Gujarat. And they have not responded to Parliamentary Committee on Labour, even after a month. So these states have suspended majority of the labour laws for a period of up to 3 years. And there are total 13 state governments which have diluted labor laws in May 2020, and 8 of them have raised the daily working hours from 8 hours to 12 hours. And also there are activists who say that these dilution of labor laws will put children at risk, because these dilution will result, and dilution of labor laws is taking place during lockdown, schools are closed and reverse migration is taking place in rural areas, and lakhs of children are already into child labor, and further the children would be forced to into child labor, and already those who are working would have to work for longer hours too, and for a lesser pay. So India contributes to nearly 15% of global child and adolescent laborers. So we need to take steps to ensure that this is corrected, rather than relaxing labor laws, which will result in further adverse situation. Next is Jamaat challenges plea in Supreme Court over law on places of worship. So this is Jamaat Ulama Hind, which has asked the Supreme Court for a chance to contest a petition filed by a Hindu body to quash the legal provisions which protect barbarous actions of invaders who have converted Hindu places of worship. So it is a known fact that Muslim invaders in the medieval period, they brought down Hindu places of worship and converted them into Islamic places of worship. So now Jamaat Ulema Hind has approached the Supreme Court, because there is a petition filed in the Supreme Court by Vishwa Bhadra Pujari Purohit Mahasangh. So this petition is actually challenging the validity of Section 4 of Places of Worship Special Provisions Act of 1991. So this act validates the alleged illegal and barbarous actions of invaders who had converted Hindu places of worship into places of Islamic worship. So this is what is being challenged, that this protection should not be given to Islamic places of worship, so which is provided under this act. So how can these illegal acts be validated? So that's the question being raised. So specifically the case is of Kashi and Mathura, where two mosques are located. So Jamaat has approached the Supreme Court, and it says that how the Ayodhya judgment had held that law cannot be used as a device to reach back in time and provide legal remedy to every person who disagrees with the course which history has taken. So Jamaat is saying that it wants to intervene in this petition which has been filed in the Supreme Court. So it all depends on how things are taken forward, because even in the Ayodhya case, when the mosque was allowed to be converted into a temple, now it has been decided that it is a temple. Alternate land has been provided for building a mosque, a brand new mosque. So such steps may be taken that alternate land is provided, and if it done harmoniously with both parties agreeing and taking things forward, it would be beneficial. Otherwise, if it affects the social fabric of the country, it will be detrimental to the nation's integrity. Then next is individual contributions to NDRF gets green light from Finance Ministry. So the Finance Ministry has given approval to a proposal to allow individuals and institutions to contribute directly to the National Disaster Relief Fund. So there is a National Disaster Relief Fund which is there under Disaster Management Act of 2005. Section 46 provides for it to meet the expenses for emergency response, relief and rehabilitation for any disaster situation. So though this Disaster Relief Fund, National Disaster Relief Fund is there, there are two other funds. One is Prime Minister's National Relief Fund, and the new fund PM CARES, which has been initiated. So what is being seen is, when an RTI was done for PM CARES fund, the RTI was returned. It was said that this is not a public authority, so details cannot be provided of how much fund has come in through various contributions and where it is being used. So information was not revealed, saying that this is not a public authority. Also, Prime Minister's National Relief Fund is not a public authority. So there also details would not be provided. They are established under a trust. So now, since they are not public authorities and are not answerable under RTI Act, the now a petition has been filed in the Supreme Court saying that all this money should be from Prime Minister's National Relief Fund and PM CARES Fund should be transferred to National Disaster Relief Fund, and individuals and institutions should contribute directly to this. So on this, actually, Union Home Secretary had stated there is no objection to the proposal, and Finance Ministry has also given its approval. But the approval is for making contributions. The petition goes further. It wants the money to be transferred from these two funds, PM CARES and PM National Relief, to NDRF, which the Supreme Court is hearing. So that is not there. But now they say NDRF, you can make contribution to NDRF as well. They do not want to give up the funds where they will not be questioned on where the money is coming from and how it is being used. So of course the government is going to resist this. It does not want to come under RTI. So under Section 46 of Disaster Management Act, NDRF has been set up to meet the. But then, although it includes a clause for grants made by any person or institution, provisions for such donations had not been made. So now they are being made after the approval from Home Secretary and Finance Ministry. So this proposal has been approved that individuals and institutions can make deposit here too. Then next is 1,000 more Vande Bharat flights to bring back Indians. So we have already discussed the Vande Bharat mission. So under the first three phases, Air India had operated 1,170 flights with various private carriers also flying around 40 flights, and Indians have been brought back around the world. 70% presently now in this fourth phase will be operated by private airlines. So Indians have been brought back. So this is there. And one is regarding this Vande Bharat mission, which is through air route, and another one is Samudra Setu scheme, which is for bringing back Indians via sea route. Then next is Khelo India centers planned in 1,000 districts. So Sports Ministry has announced establishing 1,000 district level Khelo India centers that would be helmed by former sportspersons, starting with 100 in the current financial year. There will be 1,000 established, 100 in the present financial year itself. So these will be either run by past champions or they on their own, or they can co-opt them as coaches. So sports persons would have to personally be involved in imparting full-time training at the center to avail government grant. So it will be for various sports like badminton, cycling, sports, hockey, judo, table tennis, weightlifting, wrestling, football, etc. The next is boycott Chinese goods, says Paswan. So this is Union Consumer Affairs Minister Ram Vilas Paswan, who has called for a boycott of all goods made in China. So it says that rules will soon be framed to block the import of any substandard products from China and other countries. He says that already the Ministry of Consumer Affairs has ordered that we should refrain from purchasing stationery and other administrative items from firms selling products made in China. So it says that when we send our products, export our products, many nations reject them, claiming that they do not adhere to standards. But when goods come to India, there is no strict quality control. Even he says, so we'll plug these loopholes, is what he says. And he says that it is even unfortunate that Ganesh idols, lights used during Diwali, come from China. So now ban on Chinese goods, boycott of Chinese goods is being proposed by the government as such, which of course will create trouble if it is not WTO compliant, World Trade Organization compliant, because you have to provide free market access. Then next is environment related news. So in governance policy, we saw four news items. One was regarding National Disaster Relief Fund under Disaster Management Act, Vande Bharat mission for bringing back Indians by air route, and Khelo India centers which have been planned as such, and boycott of Chinese goods announced by Union Consumer Affairs Minister Ram Vilas Paswan. So these are the four news items with respect to governance policy. Next we look at environment. So there are two news items under environment. One is regarding Lonar Lake and second is regarding the concept of urban jungle. So we'll cover these two now. So here you can see this is Lonar Lake. High Court seeks report on color change. So Nagpur bench of Bombay High Court has sought reports on the environment impact assessment of Lonar Lake from NIRI, National Environmental Engineering Research Institute and Geological Survey of India. So here you can see this is the Lonar Lake which has turned pink in color. So petition has been filed raising concerns, and Supreme Court is hearing this matter and is asking for environment impact assessment. About Lonar Lake, you should know this is actually a crater lake. So it was created by a crater, a heavy meteor which fell. So average depth of the lake is said to be 150 meter. It is 1.2 kilometer in diameter. So it's a crater circular ball shaped depression as such. So circular ball shaped depression which has been filled with water. So this Lona Lake color change has been investigated, and even a NASA expert has submitted his finding. This is Dr. Sean Wright. He says that there is a glass formation over the surface of the bedrock of Lunar crater, which is a basalt rock. So this glass formation, it is not found anywhere else in the world. And the construction of this Lunar Kinhi Road, which is taking place in nearby, the forest department has also highlighted how it is a problem, because there is large quantity of unique material called ejecta blanket, which is contained in the substance found on the moon, which is located here on the bed of the Lunar Lake. So the bench has prohibited construction of this road until further orders to the High Court bench. So meteor which enters, then next is, with 334 species, Guwahati redefining concept of urban jungle. So this is regarding Guwahati. Here it is said, along with, which is Assam's principal city actually. Though the capital of Assam is Dispur, Guwahati is the most important city in Assam. There are 1 million humans living here in the city, and there are various species which have been found in the urban areas, like Chinese pangolin, Nepal cricket frog, Bengal monitor lizard, Assamese cat snake, Asian elephant, Terai cricket frog, Ganges river dolphin, etc. So they share space with humans. So this is said to be around 326 other species of fauna which are also recorded in this region. So very few of them are caged in Assam State Zoo, which occupies 30 hectares of the 620 hectares of Hengarabari Reserve Forest. So Hengarabari Reserve Forest is an open forest considered as the city's lungs, Guwahati's lungs. And there is Assam State Zoo which is located within it, within only 30 hectares. So very few animals are caged. Others are in the open reserve forest. So this is said to be an urban jungle. So Guwahati, it says, redefines the term urban jungle with 334 and counting free-ranging faunal species living in green spaces within concrete structures. Also here within the site is located two life wildlife sanctuaries and a Ramsar site too, the Deepoor Bill Ramsar site. Even Ganges river dolphin is said to be having the status of city animal in Guwahati in Assam. Then economy indicator related news. This is regarding how exports have fallen 36% in May and imports have fallen further. You can see it is 36.47 exports fall, 51.05% fall in imports, because of which trade deficit has also narrowed. For the third straight month, India's exports have been falling as well as imports. Then next is regarding oil marketing companies increasing petrol diesel prices yet again. So they have been increasing the prices, and this is the eighth consecutive day they have increased the prices, and they are adjusting the retail rates in line with the costs, because it is said during the 82-day break which was there during the lockdown period in mid-March, the central government had, there was a freeze on the base selling price which was imposed. So center increased the excise duty to generate finances, and the base selling price was frozen. So central government was getting all the extra money which is coming, and the oil marketing companies were not. So now oil marketing companies are increasing the prices to make up for that. So, for 8 consecutive days, continuously, they have been increasing prices. So, how the petrol diesel prices come forth, you can see, this is an example given, a 2018 data related example. So, if the cost of, say, oil in the market, international market, is 35 rupees per litre. So, this oil has to be refined, it goes to refineries, it adds an amount. So, you can see 35 rupees becomes 36 rupees per litre, and it goes to retail dealers at petrol pumps. So then when people are purchasing petrol, what happens? Excise duty is imposed. So this 36 rupees becomes 55 rupees, because around 20 rupees of excise duty is imposed. So 36 becomes around 56, you can say. 20 rupees excise duty is imposed, and then after this 56 also there is a dealer margin of around 3.61 rupees per litre. So that increases price further, and then state level VAT is imposed. So central government takes 20 rupees, state level also you can see Delhi VAT is of 16 rupees per litre. So 36 rupees you can say is government tax, and 35 rupees is the price of the petrol. So that is how the final retail price comes forth. Then next is economy banking related news. So this is regarding how RBI has tightened rules for home finance firms. So for home finance company, which is also an NBFC, non-banking finance company under RBI regulation. So there's a definition for NBFC also given here. You can see a company is treated as NBFC if its financial assets are more than 50% of its total assets. Means it's a company, but it's finance company. Why? Because its financial assets are more. Or more than 50% of its total assets, and income from financial assets is also more than 50% of the gross income. So it's not a bank, but it's a financial company. So it's called an NBFC. So housing finance company is also an NBFC, but now RBI said that they have to provide 75% of the home loans to individual borrowers by 2024. And if they do not fulfill this criteria, then they'll be treated as NBFC investment and credit companies, not as housing finance companies. So target has to be reached gradually. You can see 60% by 2022, then 70%, and finally 75% by 2024. Also, it says that qualifying assets, what will be the qualifying assets for NBFCs, housing finance companies, that is also being defined by RBI, that this is asset which is loan which has been taken for construction of new dwellings or for renovation of existing dwellings. So that those are called qualifying assets. Now, non-housing loans will not be included in the calculation, and also if it can give loans to group company also, like retail estate business can also be given loan, and retail individual home buyers can also be lended to, but both cannot be undertaken together because then it will be double finance. Means the company which is building is being financed by a bank, and the home buyer is also financed by the bank. That becomes double financing. So, in order to address this concern, RBI said either of the two can be done by a lender. Also, minimum net owned fund of 20 crore is proposed by the central bank for housing finance companies as compared to 10 crores presently. So there are restrictions and conditions being imposed on housing finance companies by RBI now. Then, bilateral related news, the first one is, in a first combat fatality in 45 years along the line of actual control, 20 Indian personnel, including a colonel, were killed in violent clashes on 15th June 2020 along LAC in Ladakh. So this, you can see the Galwan Valley region. This is the Galwan River flowing here and the Shyok River. So this is the LAC which is shown here, and this is the Daulat Beg Oldi Darbuk Road, where construction has been undertaken by Indian government. So this has resulted in tensions between India and China, and we have seen in a combat 20 Indian soldiers being killed in Galwan. So it says all troops on border duty. Then there are questions raised by the opposition whether the troops were not having arms. So on this, the clarification has been given by External Affairs Minister that all troops on border duty carry arms, especially when leaving post. So they were also carrying arms here, but then there is a long-standing practice to not to use firearms during face-offs. So there is a confidence building measure in the military field which has been signed between India and China along the LAC. So they should not open fire and cause biodegradation, etc., within 2 kilometers of LAC. But then routine firing activities in small area firing ranges, this does not apply, but in general it is there. And de-escalation talks are also taking place. But even despite this being undertaken, we have seen the standoff continues and 20 Indian soldiers have been. This standoff has been going on since May 5-6, when a scuffle took place in Pangong So area in Ladakh between Indian and Chinese forces. Second scuffle took place on May 9 at Nakula in Sikkim. And now 3 days after clashes in Galwan Valley of Ladakh, 20 Indian soldiers have died. And China has also released now 10 Indian Army personnel, including a lieutenant colonel and 3 majors from their custody. So tensions along the LOC are high. LAC, not LOC. LOC is between India and Pakistan, and LAC, line of actual control, is between India and China. So if you look at the map too, you can see a detailed map is also provided here. So this is the Galwan Valley here. This is Siachen Glacier. This red line is LAC, line of actual control. So part of Jammu and Kashmir, Aksai Chin, has been occupied by China since the 1962 India-China war. And this is LAC running through, and here the Galwan Valley lies near the LAC, which is being claimed by China. So the dispute is over actually where Galwan River originates. So China's government says that it claims the entire Galwan Valley, and the site of June 15 clash on the border, all that area is covered by it. too. Currently, those areas which are on Indian side of LAC are also being claimed by China. So LAC runs east of the confluence of Galwan and Shyok rivers. So Galwan river, where does it originate, is a dispute. And India, Chinese government says, has been unilaterally building roads, bridges and other facilities in the Galwan Valley. So it says Galwan Valley lies on our side. So India cannot have construction activities here. And that is why you can see clashes have taken place. So LAC is actually not demarcated. And there are differing perceptions on a large number of locations across the LAC. But Galwan area was never a point of contention. But now Chinese government has raised this concern. This is there. And this is the Dabrug Shyok Daulat Beg Oldi road, which has been here. You can see the government is developing this road. It runs parallel to the LAC. So, a key all weather access to the post in Daulat Beg Oldi are being proposed to be provided by the government of India. So, because of this road construction, Chinese government has raised objection and is claiming the entire Galwan Valley. Galwan Valley actually derives its name from River Galwan, which is, and the river also has been named after Ghulam Rasul Galwan, which was a British era, who was a British era explorer from Leh. So, Galwan. So it provides direct access to Aksai Chin from India. And Aksai Chin has been captured by China, we saw in the map. India is actually building a bridge over Galwan Nala about 75.5 km from the line of actual control. And China suspects that India might attempt to recapture Aksai Chin. So that's why it has become aggressive now. The next is two Indian High Commission staff abducted, released by Pakistan. So two Indian nationals employed as drivers in Indian High Commission in Islamabad went missing for hours. And now they have been released by authorities in Pakistan. The Pakistani authorities said that they were involved in a traffic accident and were arrested. India has launched a strong protest against this incident, because this is just a fortnight after India expelled two employees of Pakistan High Commission in New Delhi on espionage charges. So since then, Pakistan has also been taking counter actions in this manner and harassing Indians working in the commissions there. The next is arms-laden drone downed in Jammu and Kashmir. BSF says it flew in from Pakistan. So this was a drone, unmanned aerial vehicle. And it was having sophisticated rifle and grenades loaded on it. So it was flying along the international border and had reached Kathua district of Jammu and Kashmir on 20th June. And the border security force shot down this drone. It was a made in China hexacopter drone. So it is suspected to have come from Pakistan, carrying arms. So this is a major concern. Then next is India-China press ahead with aid to countries across South Asia, Indian Ocean region. So this is India and China both in the context of COVID-19 epidemic are providing, during the pandemic, providing support to various countries in South Asia and Indian Ocean region. So medical supplies are also being provided, medicines, protective care, and also the offer is there to have medical teams stationed in the country. So, Nepalese Prime Minister KP Oli has decided not to accept medical teams from either India or China. They say we have our medical staff, health professionals which are capable to handle the pandemic. We welcome medical material from both India and China, but not medical professionals. So, actually China is also planning to build this Health Silk Road initiative. So, it has this Health Silk Road initiative in place, in which China has sent 29 medical expert teams to 27 countries, including even military medical teams to Pakistan, Laos and Myanmar. So India has also sent medical teams to Maldives, Mauritius, Comoros, Kuwait, and has prepared, army has also prepared rapid response teams. So this is the development taking, competition between India and China in the Asian region. So this is regarding the Belt and Road initiative of this Chinese government too. So many countries are involved here, you can see BRI countries are shown in green. So across Africa, Asia, countries are involved, even South American countries have been roped in. So Belt and Road Initiative is already in place, and now this is Health Silk Road. So with, under the context, in the context of pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic, now this medical expert teams are being stationed. Then comes international related news. So first one is, Now China embraces Bangladesh in trade. So China has announced tariff exemptions for 97% of exports from Bangladesh, including fisheries and leather products. So Bangladesh is a least developed country, and that is why Chinese government has provided exemptions for exports from Bangladesh. So it will help Bangladesh cushion the economic impact of the pandemic too. So it's going to be a possible beneficiary. Other countries which will benefit are Vietnam and Chile also. So US-China trade war is undergoing, and now Bangladesh imports as such are being facilitated in China. So Chinese goods are also imported by Bangladesh. So that is worth $15 billion, but exports from Bangladesh are quite meager. So there is a huge trade deficit between China and Bangladesh. So this will also be corrected by this tariff exemption. Also, Bangladesh has been supported, being a least developed country, it already receives tariff exemptions under Asia Pacific Trade Agreement, APTA. So you should know about APTA also. This is trade relation between Bangladesh and China. So APTA is actually a trade agreement, preferential trade agreement, which has been signed under the auspices of ESCAP, UN ESCAP, United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and Pacific. So APTA includes countries like India, China, Bangladesh, South Korea, Laos, Sri Lanka, etc. So earlier it was called Bangkok Agreement and has been in place since 1975. It was renamed as APTA in 2006. It is to promote and sustain mutual trade and economic cooperation. The next is US marks end of slavery on Juneteenth. So Juneteenth is the date, 19th June of 1865, when a Union General Proclamation was announced in USA, in which slavery was abolished. All slaves were announced to be free. So this Juneteenth, we celebrate every 19th June. So in 2020 also, United States marked the end of slavery by celebrating Juneteenth. It is not an official holiday. It's an annual unofficial holiday. And some places are demanding it be declared as an official holiday. So presently also we are seeing Black Lives Matter protests going on in USA because of death of 46-year-old African-American George Floyd, who was killed on 25th May when a white Minneapolis police officer pressed his knee onto his neck for nearly 9 minutes and ignored multiple pleas of "I can't breathe." And the African-American George Floyd died. So millions have taken to the streets since then with hashtag Black Lives Matter trending. And such protests have taken place across the globe in various countries in Europe and Australia and other nations too. So this is Juneteenth, also known as Emancipation Day, symbolizes end of slavery and commemorates the reading of Republican President Abraham Lincoln's General Order No. 3 on June 19, 1865 in Texas, which announced freeing of slaves. Then next is Trump's police reform order discourages use of chokeholds, creates database tracking misconduct. So this news is also in the context of George Floyd, who died because of chokehold. So now President Donald Trump has passed an executive order for police reforms to encourage better police practices. Also, it says that he created establish a database that tracks police officers with excessive use of force complaints in their records. So this database would be created and use of chokeholds would be discouraged. So it means it would be banned except if officer's life is at risk. So such an executive order has been passed. The next is presidents can't shut down DACA, says US top court. So US Supreme Court has ruled that US government may not immediately proceed with its plan to end a program protecting about 7 lakh young immigrants who are known as dreamers in the country. So they are proposed to be deported, but US Supreme Court has ruled this cannot be done presently. Why it has ruled so, there's an interesting reasoning being given here, we'll see. So these dreamers, there's actually a program called DACA, Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. So these childhood arrivals are called DACA. So who are they, you should know? They are actually young people who have been brought to US as children, and they can apply now for temporary status according to this program which was announced, DACA, announced by then President Obama, Barack Obama, in 2012. But the President Donald Trump had his central campaign during elections too that he would immediately terminate by an executive order former President Barack Obama's this amnesty program for hundreds of thousands of young immigrants. So this has been challenged and Supreme Court has stayed it. It says that the DACA program actually allows young people brought to US to have temporary status that shields them from deportation and allows them to work in the country. But this status is for 2 years and is renewable, and it does not provide a path to citizenship. So this is DACA, because they came to the country as young children and they don't know any other country. So they have born and brought up in USA. So that is why this DACA program was there, providing them temporary status, allowing them to work and protecting them from deportation. So DACA actually has been rescinded by US President Trump, and the reason being given is not justified. So Chief Justice of USA wrote that we do not decide whether DACA or its rescission are sound policies, whether it should be there or should not be there. That is not what we are looking into. US court says that we address only whether the agency complied with the procedural requirement, that is, it provided a reasoned explanation for its action. So President Trump, this 2012 DACA program of the former government was rescinded by him in September 2017. He said he would wind down the program, and only single reason he gave for doing so is that creating or maintaining the program was beyond the legal power of any president. This was the reason he gave, which is not justifiable, is what US Supreme Court is saying presently. So it says that government may have give better justification for ending the program, and then it may go ahead. So that will take months, because then lower courts will have to look into that, whether that is justified or not. So that's how the process has been delayed by the judiciary, and DACA's security is still being provided to young immigrants. So who are DACA, who is eligible for it? You can see those who arrived in US before age of 16 years, and those who were born on or after June 15, 1981 and have lived in the US since June 15, 2007. So they are currently in school or have high school diploma or have served in US military, they qualify for DACA. So you can see they can apply for DACA status as such, and they get 2 years deferment period, work permit. They can apply for students' loans, driver's license, they can get a social security number too. But it said this is not the roadmap for giving them citizenship. The next is, France slams provocation as US halts talks on taxing digital giants, GAFA. So GAFA, we already saw in the introduction, GAFA is Google, Apple, Facebook and Amazon. So these are digital giants, and how they should be taxed is a concern. So US is the country of their origin, and they are actually functioning in various other countries, and they do not pay taxes over there. So US and European countries actually under the auspices of OECD, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, were negotiating on how digital giants should be taxed. But now USA has announced that it will not be, you know, taking further these talks. So France and US have now locked horns. So US broke off talks, which were actually to have a global framework for making the companies pay larger levies where they are operating. So they'll pay taxes, but where they should pay taxes, in USA or in the country where they function. So USA was having talks, now it has broken the talks. It's breaking off talks. So this is there. So it says GAFA, digital giants, they unfairly exploit tax rules that let them declare profits in low tax havens, depriving them of a fair share of their fiscal payments. So they actually have their centers established in tax havens also, low tax countries, and then they are not liable to pay taxes in countries where they actually function. So France, Britain, Italy, Spain have already sent a reply expressing their desire to agree on fair digital tax at the level of OECD. So OECD, comprising of 137 countries, has started in June 2020 talks for a deal on how digital giants have to be. But now US has broken these talks. It says that these talks are discriminating against American firms. So already you can see European countries have fined digital giants for abuse of dominant market position, as Google has been fined. You can see $250 million, $13 billion fine on Apple. Because state aid was provided by Ireland to Apple. It was ordered to pay back taxes up to the tune of 13 billion euros. So various tech giants have been fined by European countries. And now a digital tax talks going on has been halted, has broken. Then next is North Korea vows to redeploy troops in demilitarized zone. So we'll just have a recap of what we did so far in international news. One was regarding China-Bangladesh trade relations, how Bangladesh has been given concessions by China for being a least developed country. Then we saw in USA, international news with respect to USA regarding Juneteenth, when slavery was abolished. Then regarding police reforms, again with respect to George Floyd's death. And DACA, which we saw regarding the Dreamers, deferred action against childhood arrivals. And now we saw texting digital giants, GAFA. You should know what is GAFA also. Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon. The digital giants. The four prominent ones. And next is North Korea vows to redeploy troops in demilitarized zone, which we'll cover. And then the last news here will be regarding US bill sanctioning China over Uyghurs. So looking at this news regarding North Korea redeploying troops in demilitarized zone. Actually what had happened is some North Korean defectors from South Korea, means their defectors means they are critical to the North Korean government. They are in South Korea, and from South Korea they were sending pamphlets and aid as such, food, materials such as rice, anti-North leaflets over into the country. So this has angered North Korea, and it has rejected South Korea's offer now to send special envoy to ease escalating tensions. It has also blown up a liaison office, joint liaison office, which was set up on its side of the border in 2018 as part of the peace deal between North and South Korea. So relations have been strained now. So this is the demilitarized zone, you should know, which lies between North and South Korea. So on either side, there's a 2 kilometer wide stretch of land where military activity is forbidden. So this demilitarized zone is a buffer zone which was established in 1953 when an armistice agreement was signed during the Korean War. So Korean War has still not been ended, though that is one of the demand of North Korea too. But this armistice agreement is there, and demilitarized zone was established, which still holds. Then this is US will to sanction China over Uyghur rights. So US President Donald Trump has signed a legislation calling for sanctions over repression of China's Uyghurs as such. And this actually has come at a time when former National Security Advisor John Bolton, who has written a book in which he alleges that President Trump has himself approved this mass detention of Uyghurs. Uyghurs are actually Muslim minorities in China which live in Xinjiang province here, and they are being put in camps. They are called re-education camps by China. They call that they are being provided vocational training there and re-educated as such, in a sense that they should be not going towards extremist views. So actually religion, observing religion in China is difficult. Chinese policies are such, like in Xinjiang province also, they do not allow fasting during Ramadan. So you do not have to, you cannot practice your religious beliefs. So that's how Chinese government functions. It's a communist government. It discourages religion. And here Uyghurs, actually there have been protests going on. Han Chinese have been settled in this region, because of which extremist activities have also been seen, and the general population is being targeted now with these re-education camps, which Western countries say are actually detention camps. So US President has signed a statement that's signed this bill, which is calling for legislation, calling for sanctions against those who are involved in this Uyghur human rights violation. But then US President also said that a signing statement was given in this bill, which said that some of the bill's requirements might limit his constitutional authority to conduct diplomacy between US and China. So he would regard these provisions as advisory and not mandatory. So though he's signing the bill too, he's saying that he may not fulfill all the conditions, all the sanctions which are there. Leeway is opened as such. So this is regarding the detention program targeting Muslims in Xinjiang province shown here, a satellite image. And then the last two news which we have to cover is with respect to international organizations. So one is IAEA passes critical resolution against Iran, and the last news is India wins in UN Security Council polls. So we see these two last news items. So IAEA, you should know, is International Atomic Energy Agency, and it is UN's nuclear watchdog. And the board of governors at IAEA have passed a resolution presently which is critical of Iran. And this is the first such resolution since 2012. So Iran, we know, Iran nuclear deal was in place, and USA suddenly opted out of it when everything was going fine. And IAEA had access to various sites of Iran too, where nuclear activity was being undertaken. But then Iran decided that it's going to rescind the deal as such too, because USA has opted out and is putting sanctions on Iran, and it started its nuclear activity again. And now IAEA wants access to two sites in Iran to clarify whether undeclared nuclear activity took place there in early 2000. But Russia and China both have spoken out against such a resolution, and they voted against it too. But resolution has been passed despite opposition from Russia and China. But whether Iran complies with it or not is to be seen. So this is IAEA, international organization with 168 members, established in 1957. Headquarters is in Vienna, Austria, in Europe. And it reports to both UN General Assembly and UN Security Council. And its objective is to promote peaceful use of nuclear energy and to inhibit use for military purposes. And this is regarding the 2015 Iran nuclear deal, where how gradually it was seen that nuclear activity of Iran would be ended and sanctions relaxed. But President Trump opted out of it, saying that he wants better deal negotiated, because this was a deal under President Barack Obama. And now Iran has also again gone back to developing on further nuclear activity. And the last news is, India wins in UN Security Council polls. So India has won a non-permanent seat in UN Security Council. You already know Security Council has 15 seats. 5 are permanent members, P5, and 10 are non-permanent members. So in this UN Security Council, now seat from Asia side is to be filled, and India has won this 2-year term in the 15 member council, which will begin on Jan 2021. It will be 8th term of India in the UN Security Council, but as a non-permanent member. So UN reforms are being called for, and these are called norms. New orientation for a reformed multilateral system. It is said that this P5 permanent members, which are US, UK, France, Russia and China. So they say that these 5 countries are not the only important countries in the world representing present world dynamics. So there are reforms required. But then these P5 nations are not ready to give up their permanent seat, neither their individual veto power. So that is there. Reforms are what we are pushing for. But presently we have 1 or 2 year term. Actually, India has contested unopposed. The other candidate from Asia was Afghanistan, but it allowed India to contest unopposed by giving up its bid for the seat in favor of India. So this was there. So this. This is regarding norms which India is going to promote at UN Security Council as a non-permanent member, for push for reforms, to promote responsible and inclusive solutions to international peace and security. So India has 5S approach: Samman, Samvad, Sahyog, Shanti and Samriddhi for UN activity. So that is it. Thank you.